Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we will continue our inquiry into excess deaths in Scotland and since the start of the pandemic, and I would like to welcome to the meeting Rob Gowans, Policy and Public Affairs Manager of the Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, Lawrence Cowan, Director of Communications for Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland, Peter Hastie, policymaker for Macmillan Cancer Support, Dr. Linda Fenton, consultant in public health medicine, Public Health Scotland, and Dr. Francisco Perez Reche, Institute of Complex Systems and Mathematical Biology School of Natural and Computing Science, University of Aberdeen. Thank you for giving us your time this morning and for all your written submissions. This session will be the second of two evidence sessions with stakeholders on the inquiry before we hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on the 17th of March. Each member will have approximately 9 to 10 minutes each to speak to the panel and to ask their questions. If you would like to respond to a particular issue being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we will do our best to try and bring you in. I am keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak. I apologise, though, in advance. Therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interests of brevity. As all our witnesses are remote today, can I please just ask you to briefly introduce yourself? And can I start with Rob Gowans, please?
Good morning. I'm Rob Gowans. I'm the Policy and Public Affairs Manager at the Health and Social Care Alliance.
Thank you. And Lawrence Cowan?
Hi there, I'm Lawrence Cowan. I'm Director of Communications at Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland.
Thank you, Lawrence. And Peter Hastie?
Hello, I'm Peter Hastie. I'm the Policy and Public Affairs Manager for Macmillan Cancer Support.
Thank you. And Dr. Linda Fenton?
Good morning, Linda Fenton. I'm a consultant in public health medicine in Public Health Scotland.
Thank you very much. And Dr. Francisco Perez Reche, and I hope that I pronounced that correctly.
Hello, this is Francisco Perez Reche, so your pronunciation is great. And I'm a senior lecturer at the University of Aberdeen.
Thank you very much. If I now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. Although during this inquiry so far, some previous witnesses have said that at this stage it's still very difficult to draw any conclusions on excess deaths and we may have to wait some considerable time to do so. Although from the written submission from the Chest, Heart and Stroke, it has said approximately in the past year there's been 1,389 more deaths at home from heart disease and stroke and 679 fewer deaths in hospital. This could be a reluctance to visit a GP, and latest data in the submission says that 25% of people saying they would avoid contacting their GP still. These statistics are very worrying, and I was wondering, Lawrence, if you'd like to comment further on this.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for that. I think you're absolutely right. I think the figures are in themselves concerning, as I agree with previous witnesses to the committee saying that this, actually the full magnitude of this will become known over a longer period of time. And I also think that what we're talking about in terms of excess deaths, but also I think in terms of further complexity of cases and people having a greater impact on their everyday lives because of seeking medical help potentially later will actually have a long-term impact on our health service beyond just a few years. This is something that's going to be with us for a long time. I think there's the worry for us, I suppose, is that this has created a bit of a dangerous domino effect. I suppose there's a number of reasons behind this. I think the figures that we see. Firstly, it's that healthcare hesitancy that you talked about with the number of deaths of people being at home, also emergency admissions and presentations are still lower than average. So there's a real concern there for us that actually people. But whether that is COVID-related and fear of coming into contact with COVID, or indeed playing into that view that the NHS is actually overrun and I'll be okay. I'll see if things get better later. That's really worrying for us. So for us, I think we really do need to be addressing that. There's also the wider impact that we need to take into account of what it is, of the things that we had to do during the because of the virus. So, you know, lockdown has had a big impact, increase on isolation and loneliness as well, for instance. There's a 48% of people, according to Scottish Government figures, say they're feeling isolated and lonely. And then there's actually the wider impact of policy priorities pre-pandemic, which I think are worrying for us as well, which, you know, it's about making sure that the whole system is properly integrated, and that includes charity services like ours. So we support people who leave hospital to stay well and happy at home, which then has a wider impact on their health and well-being, which then has a positive impact on services and pressures in the system. So for us, there's a mix of things that are concerning here. They're all interlinked, but as you say, I think those initial figures are quite concerning for us, and do point to some big issues that need addressing.
Thank you very much, Lawrence. I do agree with you, and I think it's trying to get people's confidence back to visit the GP and not to ignore warning signs is extremely important. If I could bring my next question to Public Health Scotland and Dr. Perez Reche. Can you give the committee your interpretation of the excess deaths data? If we bring in Public Health Scotland.
Thank you. So, I mean, I think the excess death measure is very helpful and has been a robust measure of the overall mortality impact of the pandemic period, both through COVID-19 and other causes. I think we can see three sort of phases across the pandemic of excess mortality with slightly different causes across them. In the very early phase in March and April 2020, there appears to have been a short period of a few weeks when there were deaths that are likely to have been due to COVID-19 but that weren't certified as such because of testing or diagnostic difficulties, but I think that was a fairly short-lived issue. The period over the winter 2021, excess mortality was largely driven by COVID deaths, but I think perhaps the most concerning period is in 2021, from around about May to December 2021, when we saw a consistent period of excess mortality, around about half of which was non-COVID mortality, and which occurred across a range of causes of death, with substantial contributions from circulatory causes, and also the other group, which I can go to in a little bit more detail, but is likely to be external causes like drug-related deaths and liver disease. We see that excess mortality occurring across a range of age groups, so it's not concentrated in one particular sort of cause or age group. From January, actually, there has been some improvement, and we've not seen an increase in excess deaths over the last 2 months of reported data from NRS. So my interpretation is that this is a substantial issue. There's a range of causes and deaths and age groups affected. I think we need to recognise that in view of that breadth, there's likely to be both health service factors and also factors that are related to the determinants of health. So we know that Lawrence mentioned, a lot of things have changed through lockdown in terms of people's material circumstances, in terms of their social isolation, as well as their access to services. So we need to look at also what is driving health and ill health in the first place. Just to reflect on your first question a little, I think it is possible to draw some conclusions at this point. I don't think, you know, our understanding will grow over time and the full extent will grow over time, but we can take what we know of determinants of health, what we know about health in the pre-pandemic period, and what we know about what has changed across the pandemic to draw some initial conclusions.
Thank you, Linda. Can I bring in Dr. Perez Reche, please?
So my conclusions are a lot in line with what Linda Fenton just posed. I I looked into the variability of the excess death in addition to the, say, the expected value or the mean value, say, because, and then, yeah, so I agree that the main concern is that the non-COVID excess deaths, that there was a consistent excess death in the late, well, I mean, the second half of 2021, which before that, there were excess death, periods of excess death, and periods of deficit as well of non-COVID. I'm talking about non-COVID, yeah. This periods of deficit is also important to have them in mind, yeah. Probably it might be because some people unfortunately died of COVID before the time they would have died of other disease. Yeah, this is something that seems to come out from the data. But certainly there is this period in 2021 from July or so that there is a clear, you know, consistent excess deaths of non-COVID. And this is statistically robust. It's not that because sometimes it depends how you compare things. You might find some a result or another, but in this one, I think this is statistically clear that there is an excess that I mean, a consistent excess of non-COVID deaths. And well, perhaps an interpretation could be that some people perhaps got to a point in which their disease was non-COVID related disease was already at a critical state, and then it, you know, it took 2 years, perhaps almost, or 1 year and a half for this to appear. Yeah. And this is worrying. This is worrying because it means that something has been built up in there until, you know, there were these excess deaths. Then in January 2022, the data is not that clear whether there is an excess or not, but it's not statistically significant that there is a deficit or an excess. Yeah. So it looks like at the moment we are back into kind of normal times, but for non-COVID deaths. Then my impression is that this will probably fluctuate because you have this balance between people that have died before time, and then there is a deficit of deaths. And then it might be that, you know, this time in the second half of 2021 was one of these times in which there were more deaths than expected. And then now we will go perhaps through a time in which there might even be a deficit, but certainly given the backlog, I think there will be more periods of excess death in the future. Yeah. So this is more or less my interpretation. Yeah.
Great. Thank you very much for your valuable input. I think we'll probably have to wait to see the data from this year, maybe a bit further down the track. Could I bring in Meta Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I'd just like to follow up the questions the Convener asked, both of which I think are important. And first of all, just to pick up that question of data. I was taken by the submissions both from Chest, Heart and Stroke Scotland and from Macmillan Cancer, who are both making the point that there's anecdotal evidence of people suffering from heart disease and stroke in one case, and then from cancer in the other case, presenting later at hospital, but so far it's only anecdotal and not enough data. Maybe I could ask Peter Hasty from Macmillan Cancer just to elaborate on that and when you would expect the data to appear. And then perhaps I can go to Dr. Francisco Perez-Reque, whose paper suggests that there is a bit more concrete information available rather than just anecdote. But Peter Hasty first, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fraser. Yeah, I think the figures are starting to come through. We know there was excess cancer deaths in 2020 and 2021, but we don't yet know how significant those figures are, because naturally people who died of cancer may have gone on to get cancer. And so the figures could can be fluctuating, as Dr. Perez says, but there is no debate whatsoever that cancer patients are presenting later. No debate whatsoever. Macmillan GPs, Macmillan nurses, and our extensive benefits staff, the length and breadth of Scotland, are saying that patients are presenting later. And we know that that means more advanced treatments, poorer prognosis, and more likelihood of death. You know, the cancer system was not good before the pandemic, and all of the problems that we knew existed have been exacerbated. But I think the committee today, looking at data, the data we do know is that the most recent staging data showed a reduction in stage one. Now, obviously, if you're going to get cancer, you want it to be diagnosed as early as possible. So in 2020, there was a reduction in stage one diagnosis. We expect to see the same, but we won't get the staging data until later this year. In April, we've got cancer incidence and cancer survival stats coming. That might help us later in the year. We'll have more cancer mortality and cancer staging data, which might help us. But let me just talk about one piece of evidence that is crystal clear numbers. When the Scottish Government suspended the cancer screening programmes, they said that per quarter, when they cancelled in March 2020, that would mean 248,000 fewer bowel kits getting sent out, 146,000 fewer breast screening examinations, 101,000 fewer cervical screenings. So it then lasted 6 months, so that's 500,000 fewer kits sent out. You know, 100,000 breast, 200,000 cervical. Now, we know from the Scottish Government's own figures that around 850 people would have been detected with cancer each of those quarters. So that's 1,700 people simply not diagnosed during the first 6 years of COVID. Well, it's simply plain what will be happening over that cohort. And one of the real concerns is the bowel screening programme is still in a 6 month delay. So when you're 52, you don't get your kit at 52, you now get it at 52 and 6-7 months, the same at 54, at 56, at 58. So that backlog and delay has continued. Now, eventually that will right itself. Once everybody's had it, you'll be back in a 2-year pattern. But clearly the long-term issues on cancer diagnosis being late and poorer prognosis will last for years.
Thank you, Mr. Hastie. I mean, some of the statistics you've given us are really stark, and being a gentleman of a certain age, I'm in that category of missing my bowel cancer screening. So I recognise what a problem it is. Maybe I could go to Dr. Perez-Ritchie, because in your paper, you're a bit more definitive than just anecdotal evidence, aren't you? You're quite clear there is evidence of patients presenting in a more acute condition. Can you tell us a little bit more about what you found?
This is a tricky question, yeah, given the data I had. So I tried to make the most of the data I had access to. And then what I realized is that if you compare the delay of deaths with respect to admissions, hospital admissions, yeah, then you see that at the beginning of the pandemic, the delay was between 2 and 15 days, yeah, perhaps. Then if you look at this data, which again is limited because, yeah, so, but then you look at later periods, yeah, so in particular to this period where there were more excess deaths of known COVID. I'm talking about known COVID all the time, yeah? So then it looks like the data supports the idea that the delay between admissions and death is shorter. Yeah, this might be due to many factors, including a factor could be that the registration of deaths was not made at the same pace or something like that in these periods. This could be something that has nothing to do with actually more acute disease or anything like that. Yeah, but there is at least this evidence that it looks like people that were that died in the late stages of the pandemic, well, like in the second half of 2021, died in a shorter time. Of course, one would need more data to really see if this is the case, because my evidence is supported by, you know, very limited evidence. I mean, the evidence is not so strong, I would say. Yeah. So I would ask for more data in this respect. Yeah, actual data of how long does it take for someone to get admitted to hospital or get diagnosed and die. Yeah, this is, I think, a measure that would be great to have. And I couldn't find this anywhere. Yeah. The other measure, it was the proportion of deaths by admission. So what is the proportion of people that are admitted to hospital and die? Yeah. And again, this is based on limited data, but it shows that we've been above the normal trend. This is, I think, in my figure 3 in my report. Yeah. And well, actually, in this period where there was this excess of known COVID deaths in 2021, we see that, it looks like the proportion of people that die that are being admitted to hospital is higher. Mm. So I thought this could also indicate perhaps a kind of more acute signature of more acute disease. But again, it would be great to have more detailed data to be more solid on that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I'd like to ask, if there's time, Convener, just one other question, again, following up the Convener's first line of questioning on access to GPs. Maybe I could ask this to Rob Gowans from the Health and Social Care Alliance initially. When we speak to the BMA about these issues of access to GPs, they assure us that GPs are working harder than ever. They're still seeing patients. There's never been a problem getting to see the GP. And yet, you know, the evidence we hear from people like yourself, and it's in your written submission, is there's a lot of concern from the public. They haven't been able to get GP appointments, or they've been reluctant to approach a GP. And I suppose my question is, how much of this is a supply issue? In other words, it's been difficult to get appointments with GPs because of COVID restrictions, or how much is it a societal and cultural issue whereby people just haven't been coming forward seeking GP appointments, either because they're perhaps concerned about leaving the house and catching COVID, or because they feel, because there's been so much emphasis on COVID, that they don't want to take away from that and they don't want to, you know, distract GPs from dealing with COVID patients to deal with what they might view as a more trivial matter. Do you have any insight on that?
I think there's kind of a range of issues, and some of which you've covered. I think certainly kind of during the pandemic, there's been sort of impression created for sort of many people that that you shouldn't go to the GP unless you've got COVID, and that was the priority. I think sort of as we've sort of moved throughout, it's people have found it sort of difficult to get appointments at later stages if they didn't have COVID. We've sort of recently done a sort of survey of people's experiences of accessing GPs during the pandemic, and sort of the kind of the initial findings are that around about a third of people felt that their expectations weren't met when they called the GP surgery. So this can be things like people who felt sort of uncomfortable discussing issues with sort of receptionists in the sort of triage function, and would prefer to sort of speak to the GP. We found that's kind of sort of phone appointments have worked well for some people. For others, they were concerned that about how, sort of how effective they were, and similarly with sort of digital services such as sort of Near Me. Again, while they're suitable for some people, for others who sort of haven't sort of got access to sort of a device or a sort of good net connection, they could be difficult. Also that people people don't feel comfortable moving forward that way. So I think there's kind of a mix of issues. Partly the issue around supply, and particularly at the kind of earlier parts of the pandemic, but also around the being able to sort of cope with the demand and demand in some cases, because people have sort of put off going to a GP and now they're sort of presenting in a worse condition.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Alex Rowley, please?
Thank you, Convener. I note that the Alliance, the Health Alliance, highlight that the health inequalities have widened during this period, and also that Heart and Stroke Scotland in their submission talk about poor diet, lack of exercise, isolation, all increasing during this period. So I suppose the question is, what actions does government need to do? I mean, one is the data there to demonstrate clearly that people with lower socioeconomic backgrounds are in poorer health, and that the impact has been greater, and what action needs to take place, and specifically in terms of the submission for chest, heart and stroke, there are a wide varying range of public services out there. So it wouldn't just be health services. Is there any kind of planning taking place? Should there be specific planning taking place around inequalities and deprivation in order to recover for this? I'll start with Laurence.
Absolutely. Thanks very much for that question. I think you're right. The impact of the pandemic has been more marked in areas of deprivation. Whether that is economic impact, but also societal impact. There was a recent report produced on non-communicable diseases, which was produced by the BHF, which showed that actually there were significant increases in unhealthy behaviours. That was eating unhealthily, also increasing isolation and loneliness, but also increasing the smoking levels. So. And again, that will impact your risk of stroke, heart disease and COPD, which are some of the biggest conditions that we deal with in Scotland. Are things joined up as well as they should be? I think the clear answer is no. And that is because I think it alludes to one of the points I was making beforehand. I think some of the problems that we're seeing now have been exacerbated by the pandemic, but they've also existed pre-pandemic. And that is because we've seen health very much as a medical model. So the services that we provide, when we say we keep people happy and healthy at home, that is about helping them adjust to life after a life-changing event like a heart attack or a stroke or a diagnosis of COPD. But it's also about improving their exercise. It's simple interventions like that can have a massive impact, improving their diet, improving their well-being. And that is work that we do right across the country, including in areas of deprivation. And that can have a significant impact on the someone's health, which then has a knock-on positive impact on the health service. We have not joined that up properly. For us, we need to integrate that a lot more readily. What do I mean by that? I think that's making a very, very clear diagnosis pathway and referral pathway into services like ours. It works in some health boards. In other areas, it doesn't exist. That needs to be a lot easier. At the moment, we are doing a lot of partnership working with health boards, which is really positive, but it is actually us doing the running on it. It needs to be an automatic system where the patient in the hospital, when they are discharged automatically to a wealth of services. It happens in some areas and it doesn't happen in others. So that's one of the things that we think needs to be addressed. It needed to be addressed before the pandemic, but it needs to be addressed now, because partly it's about providing a release valve for pressure for the health service, but it also improves people's health, in the areas of deprivation most markedly. So that, for me, is a real big priority as we go forward.
Thank you, that's helpful. Rob, can I ask you maybe similarly on that question of the widening inequality gaps that's taking place? I mean, what needs to happen to bring services together and work together?
I think there's a number of things that need to happen. That we know that particularly the sort of excess deaths are twice as high in the most deprived areas compared to the least deprived areas. One of the things that needed is sort of better data, and particularly disaggregated data, so you know, by age, by sex, by race, different areas to understand the impacts fully. It's also actually to take an equalities and human rights based approach to make sure that people's human rights at the heart of policy in practice, and that health inequalities can be tackled. Holistic care and support is really important in terms of particularly the House of Care model, particularly recommend. And I think as Lawrence suggested, the involvement of the third sector, the third sector's got a sort of key role to play in supporting healthcare, and should be in its sort of an equal partner. So there's she's to address sort of underfunding and undervaluing of the third sector allow it to be a sort of meaningful and valued partner in the design and delivery of care and support going forward, and that would mean kind of adequate funding for the sector as well.
Okay, thank you. And I think Dr. Fenton had something to say on that as well. Dr. Fenton.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to come in there. Just while we're on the topic of health inequalities, I was just keen to highlight that, yes, we very much do know that there are substantial socioeconomic health inequalities that precede the pandemic in Scotland and have been worsening not only through the pandemic period, but in the immediate period running up to that. We know that actually, unfortunately, from around about 2012, overall life expectancy stopped improving in Scotland, as with a number of other high-income countries. And that stalled improvement in mortality was much more acute in populations in our more deprived areas, to the extent that mortality rates were actually increasing in the most deprived areas in the run-up to the pandemic, which has then been overlain by the situation we know, in which COVID mortality was 2.5 times higher in the more deprived populations. And I think this just begins to speak to some of the underlying factors that are common across both COVID and non-COVID health that influence people's well-being and their ability to cope with challenges. So I think in terms of actions, we would very much be looking to the income supports that people are able to access and the welfare. I think we welcome the supports that have been there through the pandemic period in terms of furlough and universal credit uplift, but recognise the challenges that are likely to be there now, and the fact that people's income has been hit hard and cost of living is going up is going to limit the choices and opportunities that people have and further straighten their material circumstances, and also the consequent psychosocial impacts of that are likely to play out across this period and ahead. We would also focus on our other universal services outside health, like education and early years support, as well as housing, improving the places and spaces for people, which really brings us to think about a sort of health in all policies approach. And I think we would strongly advocate for that in the COVID recovery period, that we think about how we can address well-being and inequalities across a range of policy areas.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Peter Hastie on that question as well, but before I do, can I also ask Peter, in terms of you gave the good example of bowel testing and how there's now a delay in that, but can I ask, is COVID still having the major impact in the hospitals, or can we see a shift to non-COVID conditions in terms of those actually being seen as a public emergency? And what actions, so the example of bowel cancer, the bowel testing seems quite clear. What other actions do you believe that we need to be looking at in Scotland around the NHS, specifically to cancer? Peter.
Thank you very much, Mr. Riley. I think health inequalities remains at the heart of everything Macmillan Cancer Support wants to do. Do you know, if you live in a deprived area in Scotland, you're more likely to get cancer, you're more likely to be diagnosed later, and you're more likely to die. And I can't see how it's possible the pandemic will have improved that situation. So I think it would be great if the committee, given it's looking into excess deaths, starts to look into palliative and end-of-life care. We know there has been such a dramatic shift, but what does that mean? For some families, they may well have a household that can cope with that situation, but for many others, particularly in the poorest areas, they will not be able to cope. You know, we still don't have a palliative and end-of-life care strategy in Scotland. The last one ended 14 months ago. And I think it's key that we understand the excess deaths and what has happened to patients during this. And Macmillan would obviously input with that from a cancer level. But the pandemic is clearly not over. Yesterday, the weekly figures from Public Health Scotland showed more than 4,000 NHS staff off because of COVID, rising hospital cases again. So we are really concerned that we're going into yet another wave, and we only just came out of the Omicron wave, so it's really hard to see how we're going to continually catch up with cancer backlogs as they build up each time. And again, for Macmillan, we desperately need modelling of the cancer workforce to see how we deal, particularly with patients coming through at a later stage, because as you come through at a later stage, you need far more treatment and more end-of-life treatment. And so there's workforce issues here, and we look forward to the delayed Scottish Government's workforce strategy being published, but it has to talk about modelling of the cancer workforce. It wasn't good before the pandemic, and we are deeply, deeply concerned about the long-term trends. You know, in terms of workforce, what can we do to retain staff? We know staff are burned out. Can we do more learning and development for staff to learn about cancer and to move up their grades? Because we have a wonderful cancer workforce, but it needs supported in terms of learning and development and time off for training to keep people motivated and keep them in their posts. So there's huge issues, but health inequalities, as I suggest, remains at the centre of what Macmillan tries to tackle in Scotland.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in John Mason, please?
Thanks very much. And yeah, we've covered a bit of ground so far. I mean, the kind of balance between COVID and other conditions. So I suppose a general question to start with, you know, have we as a society put too much emphasis on COVID and taken our eye off all of these other issues? Maybe I can start with Dr. Fenton on that one.
Thank you. I think, given that we faced a novel organism with high transmissibility and high virulence, it was appropriate that we very much approached that on an emergency footing, and it was a priority not only for Public Health Scotland, but across a range of public agencies, and really has dominated our response over the initial period. I think throughout, we in public health recognised that there would be a balance between harms and benefits of how we approached that, and that is part of our role to balance that evidence and try to provide information to inform that decision making. I think that there was, as I've alluded to before, a substantial pre-existing health issues with our population. And that some of what we're seeing now in excess mortality is those continuing to play out and be exacerbated. And I would very much support a focus on addressing the underlying determinants of those. But I think it is difficult to view it as a direct almost competition between COVID and non-COVID causes, because I think there are many commonalities in the factors that will influence health and outcomes across both sets of conditions, as it were. So the very fact that we see such substantial inequalities in COVID mortality shows us that if we can do something about people's health, pre-existing health, and their ability to control their lives and their employment, then perhaps there would be much lower COVID mortality, as well as improving health in general. So
I mean,
think
if I could just press you on that, I mean, I take your point that, you know, within that there's big inequalities between those who are better off and less well off, and so on and so forth. But within a particular group, be that better off or less well off, did we put too much emphasis on COVID? Should we have been looking at cancer for richer people, cancer for poorer people?
Is your question specifically about allocation of resources within the NHS?
Yes, effectively it is, yes.
So, I mean, I guess our role in Public Health Scotland is very much focused on prevention and early intervention and less on the allocation of resources within the health service.
I understand that, yes.
Detailed information about the clinical decisions that were taken within frontline services.
Okay, thanks very much. That's helpful. I think Mr. Cowan would like to come in, perhaps.
Thanks very much. Yes, I think that I totally agree with what Dr. Fenton was saying. I think there's the, but it will become, it's a debate that will need to happen in the health service for a long time now. It's how do we share these resources out? My microphone's been muted. I kind of lost you there, sorry. Okay, no, sorry, apologies for that. So I totally agree with what Dr. Fenton was saying. I think this is going to become a bit more of a, this could be a more consistent challenge, I think, for health service planning as well, because I think the virus itself, we will still be with us, and we will have to manage its impact as well as improve how we deal with existing serious conditions like chest, heart, and stroke conditions. I think just to answer your question, I suppose, with about the focus, I think quite rightly, the focus was on a virus that was ready to overwhelm society and the NHS. I think over time, what we now have is the space to think about what do we need to ramp up to make sure that we don't create more, that we don't lead to more deaths from things like stroke, or indeed people who will experience more disability in the community because they present late. So that's why we're saying that we need to have a reinvigoration of the FAST campaign and those kind of awareness campaigns to remind people that stroke is something that you need to get urgent treatment with quickly, because we now have that space and we need to make those calls. Because just to remind people that they need to seek urgent treatment for stroke, and also remind them what the main symptoms are.
Okay, so I think I'm going to have to move on to someone else. I think Mr. Gowans would like to come in.
Briefly, in terms of the balance between sort of COVID and non-COVID, the pandemic certainly sort of isn't over in terms of the impacts that the people are feeling and the need for healthcare, and I think particularly people who were or are in some cases continuing to shield and be concerned about that. Equally, however, some sort of mentioned earlier, people have faced sort of significant access barriers to sort of healthcare during the pandemic, and I think that's not fully relieved itself. So so I think, I suppose, in terms of it's not necessarily that it was wrong to sort of take a sort of focus on COVID, but equally that sort of people's health has worsened as a result of the reduced reduced access, and in some cases it has sort of unfortunately sort of reduced people's faith in the in the NHS. So so I think going forward, it's important to sort of that sort of both are the kind of efforts are sort of increased in sort of both areas.
Okay, thanks very much. And the other point I wanted to make was, or to come back to Dr. Fenton, there was a couple of points in your paper that I was quite interested in. I just wondered maybe you could expand on them. One was the concept that cancer is one of the few conditions where staging is routinely carried out and recorded, and it's therefore presented as a proxy that may help us in understanding. So I just didn't quite follow that, why we're using cancer as a proxy. And the second one was, you talk about YLL, which I think is number of years of life lost. And that wasn't particularly a phrase I was familiar with. I assume it's commonly used in some circles. And I just wondered if that's something we should be focusing on more, just rather than, you know, number of deaths or some of the more simplistic measures, perhaps, Dr. Fenton?
Thanks, really welcome that question. So on the cancer point, I think when we're seeking to understand the point in a disease at which people seek care and the impact that earlier or later presentation has on their outcome, cancer is clearly important in its own right as one of our most important causes of mortality and morbidity, but it is also useful as we have quite rich data and also a clinical staging system. So at the time of diagnosis, patients are given a stage between 1 and 4, which describes the spread of the cancer. And that information is gathered. And for other conditions, for example, coronary heart disease and angina, there's not such a consistent way of describing at what point in their condition somebody is at the point they present. Whereas in cancer, we do have this, and it's also very closely linked then to what your anticipated survival would be and treatment response. So it will provide a way of us tracking into the future whether those things are deviating from what we would have hoped for pre-pandemic in this post-pandemic period. So I think cancer as a condition will have a function as a kind of tracker almost of this delayed presentation issue. I would agree that we could broaden our use of measures. So years of life lost is a measure that describes healthy life expectancy. So we have life expectancy, which is a sort of summary measure of deaths across the population, which is helpful for comparisons in time and place and remains important as an overall measure. Healthy life expectancy sits alongside that, but provides an assessment of the years of life spent in good health and sums those up into this summary measure. So healthy life expectancy is there in the national performance framework indicators, and I think will be helpful to continue to measure. Unfortunately, it was also falling in the pre-pandemic period and will continue to do so. There are some other measures that we could potentially consider as ways of monitoring. So the NRS recently published the avoidable mortality measure. So this is specific conditions that, that are thought to be amenable to healthcare. So there's a range of other options.
Okay, that's lovely. Thanks very much.
Very much. Can I bring in Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I would actually like to start with follow on from my colleague John Mason there around data. I think in my time in the Health and Sport Committee in the last term before COVID, one of the recurring themes was that you know, we seem to be behind the curve, not just on collection of data, but how we analyse that data. And I think that has been exacerbated greatly by the pandemic. I just wonder, looking ahead, do you think this gives us an opportunity to reset how we collect data to the benefit of the healthcare system and use that data to drive government policy on health? Can I start, please, with Dr. Perez-Resch, please?
I think it would be a good opportunity, I think, to try and and make relevant data available, you know, in a more regular basis. Now, after all, perhaps there is an awareness of how important it is to have good data and up-to-date data. And I think something that might help in this respect is if there are clear consultations with people that work, I mean, data scientists like me or professionals on this, that just to see what kind of data would be needed, yeah? Because sometimes this connection perhaps is not that clear, and then perhaps someone might come up with an idea of, well, it would be good to have this data, and then it might motivate, So what I mean is that this kind of reformulation of how data is shared or how data is collected and so on, it would be good to reformulate it in consultation with people that will ultimately analyze it. I guess this would help.
Okay, thank
Maybe
you.
It's been done like this in the past, and I was not aware, but yeah.
Thank you. No, that's very helpful. I think, you know, as I said, I think that it was a recurring theme last term around the way in which we collect data and analyse that data could be improved. And if I take that a stage further, I was really interested to hear what Lawrence Cowan said earlier around the inequalities and the sort of access, if you like, to the work that they do that was restricted because of COVID around sort of group physical activity, which I know, I think, you know, I've mentioned before, and that is more likely to happen in the sort of lower SIMD. So in that respect, I'm wondering whether that kind of data, collecting that kind of data on sort of the physical activity, you know, throughout the pandemic and the impact that has had on excess death, I wonder, using that as well as or cross-referencing that with the health data we're talking about just now, again, would help us probably integrate third sector offering into NHS offerings. I wonder if Lawrence has got an opinion on that.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks very much for that. I think we do need to see a lot more of that data. We do know have a lot of data about the impact of physical activity levels on people's general health and the lack of physical activity opportunities, I suppose, in areas of deprivation. But I think this is something wider. It's about making sure that the services available are meeting those needs. There's also a really key point for me. Data presentation is one thing and data collection is one thing. Data sharing in terms of patient data is at the centre of integration, and that is not happening. To put it politely, it is very, very difficult to do for a third sector organisation to work with the NHS on data sharing agreements. That needs to change, because that is what is standing in the way of these interventions being more smoothly and widely available, and essentially reducing pressure in our NHS and helping staff do the work that they are great at doing. So there's another element to data for me as well, which is about that making sure that data sharing is a lot smoother and more easily accessible to everyone who is helping people's wider health and well-being.
You raised a question that's again been has exercised the Health and Support Committee for a while, and it's around who owns the data and therefore how you can use the data. We'll not get into that in this committee. I know that Linda Fenton would like to come in on that, I think.
Yeah, thank you. I would recognise the need for ongoing development around about collection of healthcare data, but I think it may be helpful just to recognise the opportunity that the pandemic gave us to develop some of our data presentations. So we have made big strides, I think, in making more timely data available, not least the COVID sort of daily dashboards, but also our wider impacts dashboard, which provides monthly data on the impact on health services of the pandemic. And one thing I would highlight, I think, in terms of restart and recovery, will be the importance of bringing back to sort of comparable pre-pandemic status of our health surveys, so particularly the Scottish Health Survey, which is one of our main sources of information about people's health and well-being that doesn't rely on healthcare statistics, will be really valuable. And of course, being able to have our census this year will be invaluable in actually beginning to know our population accurately and where they live and understanding needs from that point of view. So these survey approaches will be very helpful.
If I could just finish off my line of questioning here, just to tie up what you said there, Dr. Fenton, with what Lawrence Cowan said, that need to share data. And I suppose a difficult question to ask to Dr. Fenton is, do we have the IT system underpinning our ability to collect and analyse the data?
So I think there's a range of IT systems across our health service. So some of those support that more easily than others. So I wouldn't say we have a single system that easily supports that, and certainly there are areas which would benefit from development.
Thank you.
Thank you. Jim Fairley, would you like to come in?
Thank you, convener. And welcome to the committee panel. I'm just going to go back very briefly to a question that my colleague Murdo Fraser asked earlier on to Dr. Perez about the patients not being able to get access to a doctor or choosing not to go to a doctor because of belief that the NHS couldn't allow you to see your doctor. And it was just your understanding of that you seem to be saying that the data supports that the diagnosis to death, and I hate to be so blunt about that, but unfortunately that's what we're talking about, the diagnosis to death is shorter, but it's not definitive as a result of people not seeing their doctors. But there would be no way of telling in the data that you've got that death could have been avoidable had that been shorter. Is that correct?
Well, actually, my measure was from admission to death.
Admission. Yeah, so time from admission.
Yeah, so not diagnosed, because maybe there is data I didn't look into this. Perhaps there would be ways to try and see if really there was a problem. I mean, that it could have been avoidable. Yeah. And one thing that might be that, so there could be ways, but this would require, I mean, some modeling, you know, mathematical modeling that, and it would require someone to do it, of course, not just the idea. And perhaps I think the best way would be to really have data on how long did it take from admission to death, yeah, in several periods. I think the data, rather than the modeling, would be more definitive. Yeah, okay. And that's basically
okay. Thank you.
Thing.
I'm going to go to Dr. Fenton, and again, you may not have the answer to this, but just that question kind of sparked a train of thought for me. So how has people not being able to get access to treatment post-diagnosis contributed to excess deaths, or has that been a contributor?
So I think this is one of the areas where we will still be gathering information. I think we don't have clearly, so from the example of cancer, I think the main issue there was people not presenting with symptoms or not being identified through screening. I think the evidence from the cancer data is that once people, certainly in 2020, once people presented, their time then to being diagnosed and beginning treatment was the same. But we can, I think, hypothesize from what we understand. So for conditions, say, like coronary heart disease, which might present with chest pain to your GP that occurs on exercise, if people have decided not to take that problem to their GP, then they wouldn't be started on the medications that help prevent that condition progressing, and therefore it may become more severe and lead to a heart attack in a sooner time than if they had gone when it was milder and they had been able to start on the medications that would have presented disease progression. So we can use our knowledge of the impact of secondary prevention, I guess, you know, prevention through healthcare services to understand how these delays in seeking care may have impacted.
But to conclude, there was no delay in actually getting the treatment after diagnosis had been
established. So from the 2020 data for cancer, which is what we have, is that the once patients had been diagnosed, their progression to treatment was as before.
Okay, thank you.
But certainly there, the majority issue was in patients initially being diagnosed, so either presenting to services or being found through screening.
Okay, would either Peter or, chest, heart and stroke, my apologies. Peter, would you like to come in on that first?
Yes, thank you. Obviously, earlier I talked about the screening issues and the ongoing issue around bowel, so we have that ongoing issue. And as Dr. Fenton said, you know, once you're in the health service, once you've been treated for cancer, we have superb services once you're in the system, but it was getting people into the system that has been the problem. That's a mixture of the screening programs not existing and also the various ways of people not going to their GP. And also, sadly, a lot of people are diagnosed with cancer at A&E. And again, we saw a reluctance of people throughout the start of the pandemic to come forward. We also saw a couple of weeks ago record cancer diagnostic waiting times, not just cancer, but you know, if you're trying to get an endoscopy, but we've got record waiting times. So the problem is at the beginning of the cancer journey at the moment. Once the decision to treat has been taken, then we normally always hit the 31-day target in Scotland. But this is about coming into the system with a red flag. There is a problem flagged up via a GP, flagged up via screening, flagged up via another condition at A&E. Can you get the diagnostics done? And then the decision to treat and the treatment beginning. But obviously, again, during the early times of the pandemic, there's a lot of decisions taken about people not coming in for chemotherapy and not coming in for radiotherapy. And we understand that, but it was a very difficult decision.
Okay, thank you. Laura, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the part of it, as previously said, is that healthcare hesitancy has had an impact, and you know we've discussed that quite a lot this morning. And there's also in terms of stroke in particular, it's essential that the timing of treatment is quick, and so the performance of the health service, you know, that professionals on the ground have been moving heaven and earth to make that happen during the pandemic. There's no doubt of that. But in terms of the data, if we look at the stroke care bundle, for instance, that's a bundle of targets that has been specifically set out to make sure that people get quick treatment when they arrive at hospital with a suspected stroke or a TIA, which is also known as a mini stroke. Those have been missed pre-pandemic, and they were missed again. With data that shows early pandemic data. So we've really got an eye on that to make sure to almost answer your question there, I suppose, of the wider impact of the pandemic on deaths from stroke and more disability from stroke. So that will be coming through from the stroke care audit soon. But it has been identified as something to flag in the stroke care audit, in the last stroke care audit, that there's something that they are worried about.
Okay. Can I just follow up on that process and with Dr. Fenton? The Alliance states that access to doctors was an issue in some of their evidence. We've had doctors to this committee talking about the enormous strain that they're under, and yet there seems to be this perception in the public that you can't get to see your GP. Clearly, the processes have changed as a necessity to try and deal with the pandemic. Are people just going to have to accept the fact that access to a GP going forward is going to have to be done differently?
I think that primary care is fundamental to delivering effective and efficient healthcare. So I would very much advocate for investment in our primary care services. I think determining how those best meet the health needs of the population is almost a conversation that needs to be had with the population. We need to understand those healthcare needs and meet them appropriately. I think the pandemic has had major shifts in how we provide healthcare. Some of those there will be beneficial learning from. Some of those I think will have had adverse effects. But I think there is an opportunity to review how we do provide services and how they're best meeting need. One thing I would highlight, though, that in the pre-pandemic period in primary care, there was a substantial operation of the inverse care law. So the people in the most deprived areas had the worse provision of primary care, as it were, in terms of per head of population than those in the least deprived areas. And I think that's a fundamental importance to appropriately match our primary care offer to the health needs of the population.
So can I just conclude then, having listened to all the evidence that we've heard today, is that we clearly still have a major problem in the disparity between the richer areas and the poorer areas, so the health inequalities are very clearly there, that the service, once you got into it, was actually as good as it was prior to the pandemic. We may have to change the way primary health care is delivered, and that our screening levels have to get back up to at least, if not better than where they were before, in order to allow us to get out of where we currently are. Is that a fair assumption or assessment of what you've told us today?
I think those points are reasonable. I would add to them the need to act on the drivers of ill health. So we needed to do this before the pandemic, and we still need to do it now, and that's act on the fundamental determinants of health in terms of people's opportunities and chances to build a healthy life.
Right, okay. Lawrence, would you like to come in on this as well?
Just on the point about the GPs, I think it's fair to say, you know, doing things differently, absolutely, that patients have benefited from some of that, from some of the things that have been done differently. But I think it's to emphasise that at the moment, I think they're doing things differently to manage pressure rather than being focused on improving things. Now, you know, there's a real different emphasis there. So I think for us, it's really about making sure that we can take pressure off GPs with some of the services that we offer. For example, you know, long COVID is a big condition that is causing a lot of pressure on general practice, for example. And again, we see similar problems in matching up data and sharing data among primary care, which is actually exacerbating those pressures. So from a policy level, I think it is about making sure that we do things differently to improve service rather than manage pressure. I think also just on the point about service delivery, in terms of stroke in particular, time after time, targets have been missed. So yes, while you do get to hospital, you get exemplary care, there are real warning signs of pressure in the system that we're incredibly concerned about.
Okay. The last point to make is that we're not quite out of the pandemic yet either, so.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. And can I thank the witnesses for your evidence and giving us your time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do this. I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you and good morning. We shall now move to agenda item number 2. The committee will continue to take evidence at the stage 1 of the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. The focus on this of this evidence session will be on the named person nomination contained in part 3 of the bill. I would like to welcome to the meeting Dr. Arun Chopra, Medical Director of Mental Welfare Commission Scotland, and Dr. Roger Smythe, Chair of the Legislative Oversight Forum of the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland. Thank you for giving us your time this morning and for your prior written submissions. I will give members the opportunity to speak to the panel and ask their questions. If you would like to respond to an issue being discussed, please just type R in the chat box and we'll try to bring you in. As our witnesses are remote today, can I just briefly ask you just to introduce yourselves? Would you like to come in, Dr. Arun Chopra?
Thanks. Good morning, convener and members. I'm Arun Chopra. I'm the Medical Director of the Mental Welfare Commission for Scotland.
Thank you very much. And Dr. Roger Smythe, I hope I'm pronouncing your surname correctly.
My name is Roger Smith. I'm a consultant psychiatrist and I am the chair of the Legislative Oversight Forum for the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland.
Thank you very much. And if I can now turn to questions, if I may begin with the first question. What do you believe are the potential benefits and risks associated with a proposal to remove the requirement for a nominee as a named person to have their signature witnessed by a prescribed person? Can I bring in Dr. Chopra, please?
Thank you. I think that there are many benefits towards to this proposal that we remove the requirement that the named person's signature is to be witnessed. If I could lead with some data around this, I think that might be quite helpful to the committee. There are various provisions within the Act which are there to ensure that when a person is detained under the Mental Health Act, that their rights are protected and that their voice is heard, especially at times when they're quite vulnerable. One of those safeguards is the ability for a person to nominate a named person. And one of the processes involved in that is that the named person's signature requires to be witnessed. We know from data that we hold at the Mental Welfare Commission, we have a duty to monitor the Act and how it's working. And so from some of that data, we've found that the uptake of that is around 25%. So around 25% of people who are detained under the Act have a named person. What we found from looking at 3 years worth of data, including last year's data, is that despite the effects of the pandemic and the need for social distancing, removing that requirement that the named person's signature is witnessed meant that there wasn't a further reduction in the number of people who had that safeguard. So there's a real benefit in reducing bureaucracy and allowing people to exercise their rights through having a named person.
Thank you, Dr. Chopra. Can I bring in Dr. Smith, please? Do you have any further comments?
I would agree with Dr. Chopra. I would just say that the benefits of this proposal relate back to the benefits that the framers of the 2003 Act saw in having a named person at all. The Mental Health Care and Treatment Act 2003 introduced the idea of a named person, that instead of simply going to next of kin, an individual who was or in future might be subject to the provisions of the Mental Health Act could identify a named person to look after their interests, to represent them, to help them exercise their rights, and to be kept informed about procedures under the Act. And given the benefits of that that were seen by the framers of the Act and that we as psychiatrists would like to see obtained for our patients, we want to expand as far as possible the ability of people to have a named person when they are treated under the Mental Health Act. And this proposal, although comparatively minor, we believe will enable that to happen.
Thank you, Dr. Smith. If I could just stay with you for the time being, what are some of the issues encountered when organising witnessing of a named person nomination And do any of these issues predate the pandemic?
Yes, thank you, Convener. The procedure for identifying a named person was changed somewhat with the amendments introduced by the Mental Health 2015 Act. Prior to that point, there had been a default named person. If no named person was identified, then a default named person was identified, and that was removed except for individuals under the age of 16. And alongside it was this proposal that there be a signature by the nominated person, and that signature would be witnessed by an individual from a set list of professional individuals. The reason why this proposal was enacted when many of the other easements in the Coronavirus Act were not enacted was because it was easy to foresee that at a time when you couldn't bring together multiple professional groups, and there were fewer professional groups available on site in the sort of places where patients might be looking for them, that this would provide an additional hurdle. But that hurdle was always there. In general, the greater complexity of any procedure, the less likely it will be carried out accurately and completely. And the amendments in the 2015 Act were there to try to reset the balance. There's a balance to be struck here. The rights of individuals to have a named person of their choice, and for as many people who want the named person to be able to identify and appropriately notarize a named person, is one part of the balance. And the other is to ensure that people are not placed in a position of becoming a named person unwillingly or unknowingly or without proper scrutiny by them of the roles that they would be expected to undertake. And what the 2015 Act did was it moved the balance a little bit more towards protecting the rights of those who might be unwillingly nominated. And this is a small tweak to the procedure to make it slightly more simple, slightly more straightforward, and move it back to making it fractionally more easy for an individual to obtain a named person, a correctly nominated named person. And having had the experience of its use through the pandemic, we had seen real but small benefits to that, but had not identified any attendant risks.
Thank you, Dr. Smith. I think that was a helpful insight to the history. Can I bring in Dr. Chopra?
Thank you, Convener. I would agree with that. And just to add that I think what the pandemic did is brought in difficulties around social distancing, or the requirement for us to have physical distancing, and that made it difficult for named persons to perhaps visit people in hospital where they could meet someone who might be able to witness their document, or for the person to go out and witness the named person signing the document. So there was that physical distance aspect which the pandemic has brought. However, as I kind of mentioned with the data, I think one of the things that is quite clear is that even before the pandemic, there was a difficulty in the uptake, or our data shows that there hasn't been the level of uptake that one might expect for a safeguard that has that importance. And I think that relates to knowledge of the safeguard and the need for us to really ensure that people are aware that the safeguard exists, and to reduce any sort of barriers that there might be, both those brought by the pandemic, but beforehand, in the uptake of individuals having a named person.
Thank you very much. Can I move on to Murdo Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the witnesses. I think it's fair to say we have had some concerns raised with us as a committee about this proposed change. The Scottish Association of Social Work has told us that witnessing the signature of a named person provides an opportunity to verify the named person, inform them of the role, allow them to ask any questions, ensure they understand the responsibilities, and confirm they are competent and able to perform the functions correctly. And SASW say that this is particularly important since there is little guidance around the role and responsibilities of a named person. So can I ask you to respond to that, whether you have any concerns that removing this requirement means that people taking on the responsibility of being a named person won't be fully advised of what the role involves? Perhaps Dr. Chopra first.
Thank you. I understand the concerns that are being raised about whether, you know, the witnessing actually provides a mechanism for people to discuss with the named person, have you understood that role? You see, I think that's a really crucial and important point that SASWA, the Scottish Association for Social Work, are making. But I'm not sure that we need the additional bureaucratic hurdle of the actual witnessing taking place. I think we can separate these two things and make sure that named persons are fully informed of their rights, their duties, their responsibilities. And that does take place in many health boards and local authorities where the multidisciplinary team, as well as the MHO and others, will discuss this with a named person and say, look, have you understood? And that can still take place. There is guidance, which I can speak to in a second. There is no legislative requirement currently that the witness is certifying that the named person understands the roles and duties. They're actually just witnessing from that prescribed class. So I fully understand the benefits that SASWA are discussing, but I don't think we need to add an additional bureaucratic hurdle to that. I think we need to ensure that happens anyway. With regards guidance, there is, from my perspective, good guidance, which is Scottish Government guidance, which the Mental Welfare Commission assisted with in the production of, which is a guide to named person. And I know from speaking to colleagues that in some areas that guidance is sent out to all named persons. It is up to date with all changes up to October 2018. So depending on outcomes of proceedings, there will need to be some tweaks to that. But that guidance is good and explains the process well.
Thank you, Dr. Chopra. Just before I bring in Dr. Smith, maybe I could ask a brief follow-up to that. Do you think that a nominee to be a named person should be required to declare that they understand the role, rights and responsibilities?
See, I think that's a helpful suggestion. If you look at the current form, the current form talks about, this person's signed to become a named person. And I think adding something to that to say, I understand my role, or this has been explained to me, might be a real helpful addition, which brings in some of the points that Scottish Association for Social Work were making, acts an additional check for that named person to say, could I have a bit more information or have I read the guidance? So I think that's a good idea.
Okay, thank you. And same questions, please, to Dr. Smith.
Yes, thank you. I would agree particularly with the last point that Dr. Chopra made. I could quite well understand the points the Scottish Association for Social Work were making. The particular concerns they had were things that certainly should be addressed in the process of identifying and correctly nominating a named person. The issue was whether the procedure of witnessing by a member of a certain prescribed class actually did that, because it's certainly not a legislative requirement that they do so, and that while we certainly can't speak to every instance of witnessing, our experience was that wasn't the case. It was simply witnessing that the correct person had signed rather than identifying any particular understanding. I think the idea that the form should include a declaration as well as information is a very good one. The other thing I would say is that the involvement of a named person is a process rather than an event, and that there are opportunities to engage with multiple people along the way, particularly at the outset with the mental health professional and with the mental health officer, the specially trained social worker, who will be involved at the instigation of pretty much every period of detention under the Act. And they will provide a lot of information, not just about the abstract role, but the actual duties that fall upon the named person and the opportunity they have to speak when the person that they're the named person for is under any particular section. This has got to be a process rather than an event, because if the Act works as it should, you would nominate an in-person when you are well and when the prospect of future illness and future periods of treatment under the Mental Health Act were at least theoretical and in the future. And it's only whenever those events happen that the reality would be brought to bear, and that it would be inappropriate to consider the information the person received as a named person as to their role, responsibilities, and particularly their rights, as to be contained within a period of time, a meeting, a witness meeting that had occurred maybe a year or more in the past. That would have to be a process of ongoing information to the patient about their rights and the named person about their rights and responsibilities. And so we saw it as being an ongoing process that was provided for by multiple other points of contact with the health and social care system, rather than being contained within a one-off meeting witnessing a signature.
Thank you.
Can I bring in Alex Rowley, please?
Yeah, thank you and good morning. There is a suggestion that someone could accept or be a named person without properly understanding the roles and responsibilities that go with that. I mean, is that a concern that is genuinely there, that has there been problems in the past, or do you think that actually we're just cutting out some bureaucracy and there is no real threats? Could I start with Roger Smith, please?
There's what we had seen it as largely to agree with the point you opened with, that it is a small bureaucratic step that didn't contain, as we had experienced or could foresee, any real threats to named persons being unwittingly or unwillingly nominated. Again, this is a balance. This is a balance between ensuring that as many patients as possible have a named person of their choice against procedures to ensure that people do not end up as named persons against their will. But we saw the benefits of expanding the number of people with an appropriate named person because of reduction of unnecessary bureaucracy as significantly outweighing that theoretical risk that we had not seen as clinicians in the practice of the Act since 2017 when the new procedures came into place. Also, this is not the only opportunity. An individual has an opportunity to make a declaration that they are no longer a named person. This doesn't tie anyone in to anything. And that would apply throughout their role as a named person if they decided that as their own personal life moved on, or as the duties became more onerous, or as they simply, as someone else would became more appropriate, they could quite easily make a declaration that they no longer wish to be an in-person. So they were in no sense trapped. So essentially we saw it as obtaining a benefit at only theoretical cost and no practical cost.
Okay, thanks. Dr. Chopra.
Thank you. I recognise the point you're making. I suppose I'd start by saying it's a really important role, being a named person. You have the right to be consulted on any measures that are being taken, compulsory measures that are being taken towards the person you're the named person for. You have the right to make an appeal on their behalf. You get everything that goes to the tribunal, to the patient, will also go to their named person. So it's an important role and an important safeguard, and you'd want people to undertake that role, understanding it very well. There are processes within the law which haven't changed and which are just the same, which ensure that when someone is nominating someone as a named person, that they fully understand who they're nominating, why, and that they're not doing it under duress. So if I take your question and kind of just move slightly upstream from the process of the named person, there is a process to make sure that the person who's nominating a named person isn't doing that under any duress and is fully understanding of all the information that's going to go to their named person. Second point, just around data again. I already mentioned that, over the course of 3 years, only about 25% of people who've been detained have a named person. When you break that down by year, so 2018, 2019, 2020, you're not seeing huge differences So even when these measures were commenced in 2020, we didn't see a massive rise in the number of people who became named persons, nor did we see a fall. So that's important to note, that there hasn't been a huge change just because this measure was brought in. And then the third point to make is that there are safeguards available if there is someone who has become a named person and is deemed to not be appropriate to be within that role. So Dr. Smith has already mentioned mechanisms available to the person or the patient at that point to say, do you know what, I don't want this person to be my named person. But there are also mechanisms available to the mental health officer for the person or for professionals who are working with them, or indeed anyone who has a role in the welfare of that person, to say to the tribunal that this person isn't appropriate to be a named person. So there are safeguards both upstream and downstream of the aspect that you were asking about.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in Jim Fairley, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. Dr. Chopra, you may just have answered my question, but first of all, can you define for me who the people are as somebody who would require a named person?
So, in fact, the Act actually points towards this because it says any person can nominate someone to be a named person. But the value of having a named person really finds its expression when someone is subject to compulsory powers under the Mental Health Act. So when someone is well, if they have a mental health condition which they recognise may cause them to require compulsory treatment in hospital under detention, they can nominate someone to be their named person. They can even do it, you know, at the point of detention, if they understand and have capacity to understand what it means to have a named person. They can appoint someone as their named person. That person then, and I did start to talk about this in response to the previous member's question, they then have all the same rights as the patient to have all the information provided to them about what's being said about them, all the tribunal paperwork goes to them. If a doctor or a social worker is planning to take any measures, compulsory measures under the Mental Health Act, they have to advise the named person of what they're doing and they have to consult with them. So they're the sort of powers and they're the sort of people for whom having a named person is really important. So we are talking about some of the most vulnerable people who are subject to mental health law, who get the most benefit from having a named person.
OK, so can I just clarify? This is not the same as somebody being given power of attorney. This is a separate thing.
This is a completely separate thing under the Mental Health Act, Care and Treatment Act, Scotland 2003. That provides a safeguard for anyone who's been detained under the Act to have someone who is important to them. Dr. Smith was emphasising the point about choice. This is someone who a person has chosen to say, do you know what, if I'm detained under the Act, I want this person to know everything that's going to happen to me and receive all the paperwork about me. I want the doctors to consult with my named person about measures that they're taking. I want them to be advised of anything that you're doing to me. So that's what the named person is. It's different from that power of attorney.
Excellent. That's of great importance. Thank you very much. In terms of when that person, are they entitled to change I think you just answered this, but they are entitled to change a named person at any given time. But if they are in, for instance, an episode in hospital, that named person would stay until an episode passed. Is that correct?
Yes, unless they felt and they had capacity to say, I no longer want this person to be my named person. And then they can make a revocation and they'd be assessed that they have capacity to make a decision that they don't want that person to be their named person. But generally speaking, people will make their nomination around having a named person either when they're well and they've experienced an episode of detention, and then before they're ever detained again, should that event ever happen, and hopefully it doesn't, but they're able to say, if this happens, I would like this person to be my named person. And then what happens at the point of an assessment around whether someone needs to be detained is that the mental health officer, so an especially trained social worker who's got extra experience in mental health, will do their absolute utmost to ascertain whether this person has got a named person and involve them in any discussion.
Okay, thank you.
There is also the process around, so there's two types, I won't go into too much detail, but I think this is really helpful to understand the pathway. And again, it fits with what Dr. Smith was saying, that let's not view this as an event, but as a process. So when people are first detained under the Mental Health Act under what's called a short-term detention certificate for about 28 days, we've found that only 11% of people have a named person. When you start looking at compulsory treatment orders, it reaches around a quarter, around 25%. You can see that even during the process of being detained, people are able to uptake safeguard. I mean, the levels are really low, and I'm conscious of that as I'm saying that.
Yeah.
But you can see that even during an episode of detention, that safeguard becomes available to people.
Okay, so just to clarify, what we're actually, this bill is doing, what's happening here, is that the requirement for the witness to be, the signature to be witnessed is what we're doing. But would it make more sense for the legislation to ensure or to require anyone who is going to be a named person to have given sight initially of what it means to be the named person and for them to then acknowledge that, which is, I think, what Murdo Fraser was saying?
I totally agree with that point. I think it's really helpful for them to have had guidance and for them to be able to say, yes, do you know what, I've been made aware of what powers I have, what duties I have, what responsibilities I have. And that's much more helpful than a bureaucratic step that requires them to find someone who can witness their signature.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I move on to John Mason, please?
Thanks very much, convener. I think probably just one question, which would be, I mean, you've kind of touched on those other issues here apart from just the witness. And I think there may be reforms to mental health legislation at some stage. So I'm just wondering if it would be better to leave this. This is just one small change. Would it be better to leave this and look at the wider issue of a mental health legislation? Because, I mean, specifically, I'm very concerned that only 25% of people have a named person. And, you know, there's something bigger here than just the witness, is there not? I don't mind. Dr. Chopra.
I agree. I think this is one of the points that was made when they were last looked at the Mental Health Act with the 2015 amendments, and there was discussion then that we really do need to promote this as a safeguard. It was in response to this committee that we actually started to explore the data set that we had to understand the level of uptake. So I think this has been helpful to provide a sort of benchmark for Scotland as to where we're currently at. So I think that was really, it's helpful that we're looking at this. So I think we do need to do more. And my colleagues who I spoke to about this, again, in preparation, said we can't just leave it at the, and I know I've done this today talking about mental health officers and their specific duties, but it is the duty of the whole multidisciplinary team. It is a process rather than an event. So we all need to do better at making sure our people who are likely to be detained or patients have a named person. Should we leave it for mental health legislation? I think that this is something which we've highlighted now. The pandemic has put a spotlight on it. We've made a change which has actually been good. And I would say that we press ahead and enshrine this so that we can build on where we are. I think we are some years away from the provisions of a new Mental Health Act or new mental health legislation, however that looks. And I would be keen, and you know, the Commission is there to protect folks' rights. And I would be keen that that this takes place as soon as is possible for people.
That's great. Helpful. Thanks. Dr. Smith, anything else?
No, I agree with Dr. Chopra. The John Scott's review to the Scottish mental health law, as you certainly know, is due to produce this draft consultation in a couple of weeks. But legislative change, it'd be some years away. It's very unlikely that, had there not been a pandemic, that we would be asking the Scottish Government to produce primary legislation for this particular point. But what we're doing is looking at how the Act, with this amendment, operated during the pandemic and feeling that it offered patient benefit that should be sustained through the several years until any new legislation is in the statute books.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much. And that concludes this part of our evidence session. I'd like to thank Dr. Chopra and Dr. Smith for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks are happy to liaise with you on how to do that. The committee's next meeting will be on the 17th of March, when we will take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on the inquiry into excess deaths in Scotland since the start of the pandemic. We will also take evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery on the latest ministerial statement on COVID-19 and subordinate legislation. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and for the meeting to move into the private session. Thank you.